from Paul's letter to the Romans, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. It is in the spirit of that love that I approach you today. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. We are more than conquerors. Nothing in all of creation will separate us from the love of God. This is perhaps one of the most comforting and one of the most familiar passages we have from the Apostle Paul, but it is, when you get right down to it, also one of the most challenging. Because while Paul does not offer us any sort of a Pollyanna assurance that everything will work out for the best, and he doesn't encourage us to just let go and let God, though the latter might sometimes be helpful and necessary, and the former might sometimes prove to be true. Rather, what Paul is proclaiming here is that no matter what happens to you, no matter what life throws your way, because of God's relentless and unfailing grace and love for his people, he will always, somehow, work on our behalf, often in ways that we don't understand or comprehend, to protect us, to bring about the fulfillment of his purposes, and to bring us closer in relationship to him. And while this promise often isn't obvious or demonstrable to the uninvolved spectator, or to the unbeliever, or to the critic, it is made perfectly clear, and it proves itself time and time again to be true to those who love God, those who believe, and those who answer readily the call he places on our lives. Comfort and challenge, in equal parts, I would say, is what we get from Paul in this portion of his letter to the Romans. Now, I think it's important in this moment to offer something of a theological framework for Paul's proclamation. A couple of months ago, I came across an article from a Catholic bishop that I often follow, Robert Barron, and the article was entitled "Tragedy, Contingency, and a Deeper Sense of God." Barron wrote about how when we experience tragic moments in our lives, they tend to point us, often quite painfully and inconveniently, to a basic and general truth about the nature of life and of all living things. It's a truth, he wrote, that we all know in our bones, but one that we choose typically to cover up or overlook. And it has to do with the radical contingency of this world and of our lives. Contingency, in the philosophical sense, means, to state it simply, that everything in our experience is unstable. It comes into being and it passes out of being. Every plant, he wrote, every animal, every insect, every cloud, every mountain, every planet, every solar system, all life and matter, if we allow for a sufficient passage of time, it will come to be and it will eventually fade away. Again, while we usually try to distract ourselves from this fact, the contingency principle applies also even to each and every one of us. And so whenever we experience a loss or a tragedy or a moment of uncertainty with our health or our future, this truth manages to break through our defenses and can leave us feeling helpless and hopeless. But before we go too far down that road of existential crisis and despair, and let's just pause for a moment and recognize and admit that that's a very easy thing to do. It doesn't take much effort at all to simply give up. In fact, what's much more challenging, what requires much more rigor, and what is ultimately much more meaningful and fulfilling for us is to follow in the example of Paul and to seek a deeper truth and meaning in the face of fragility, hardship, and even loss. So to avoid the easy road of despair and to take instead the hard road of faith, we need to remember the work of the great theologian Thomas Aquinas, who was himself influenced by the earlier work of Aristotle And both of them would remind us that the very contingency of a thing tells us that that thing doesn't contain within itself the reason for its own existence. In other words, everything that is fleeting, everything that is contingent, something has caused it, something has brought it into being, and something has given it purpose. And as we think about and examine what has caused something that is contingent, what has given it, in fact, life and purpose, and as we continue to search for and appeal to one after another contingent causes of one after another contingent states of affairs, our pursuit, our journey will ultimately lead us to the conclusion that some cause that is not itself caused, some cause which in turn causes all other contingent things to be, some cause is at the source of all life and being. There must be, if I haven't lost you yet, to use the language of Thomas Aquinas, there must be a first cause, an unmoved mover. At the center of the entire world, everything that we observe and engage with our senses, behind and beyond all of the other causes, all of the other contingencies, everything that is fleeting, at the center of all of that is God, who sits in a place of eternal strength and stability, the first caused, the unmoved mover. And what Bishop Barron insists in his article, and I strongly agree with this, is that moments of tragedy do in fact spark within us a deeper awareness of the contingency of life, but they can also in turn give rise to a deeper sense within us of God as the eternal, unmoved, everlasting force of love and life. The one who causes us, if you will, who gives us life and purpose, who stirs within us a desire for peace, who moves us to works of righteousness, who nudges us away from the paralysis of despair and ever into the spirit-driven winds of hope and faith. He is the one who can work through that which we do not understand, that which is uncomfortable and uneasy, to bring about some good, to give new meaning, to make us stronger and more faithful on the other side of whatever it is that ails us. To go back now to Paul's proclamation to the Romans, we are more than conquerors, not ever by some heroic mustering of our own inner strength, for the contingency of the world will always ultimately fail us, but because instead of and through him who made us, who gave himself up for us, because of him who loves us and keeps us, because of him in whose hands our lives and destinies are most certainly made strong and secure. The first cause, the unmoved mover. In Matthew's gospel, this truth is made known in the parables as the highest good. To believe and trust in God's saving action is the most precious, courageous, transformative, liberating thing we could ever do. But again, this is a truth that we must work hard to uncover and acknowledge and protect. And it's a manner of life that takes discipline and rigor. One commentator noted in relation to the parables that we heard today that, interestingly, this global pandemic has illustrated to us how something so very small, something that is actually invisible to the eye, can grow rapidly and exponentially into a destructive force that consumes all of our attention and resources as individuals, communities, as nations, and as a world. But Jesus, however, gives us a counter image to this destructive and insidious force. He describes how the kingdom of heaven can emerge from something almost invisible to the eye, how it can grow exponentially, offering us sustenance, a treasure worthy of all of our attention and resources, something that can save us and set us free, but we've got to find it and protect it and lift it up. It seems to me that both implicitly and explicitly, each of these readings that we've heard today present us with a choice. Will we look for, discern, lay claim to, and represent the fierce and unfailing love of God, which is so often at work in subtle, gentle, and even unintelligible ways? Or will we take the easy way out? Will we give in to the destruction and despair, the feelings of aimlessness, meaninglessness, and nothingness? In my mind, the separation parable that we heard today, the one about the good fish and the bad fish, and the other parables even that Jesus tells that present us with a similar fate of weeping and gnashing of teeth, he tells these not so much to scare us necessarily, I don't think, but rather to get our attention. There are two different ways you can choose to live, he could have almost said, and the fates of each have no doubt been sealed. This isn't all that different, of course, than the exhortation God presented to his people through Moses as he was giving them their final instructions and preparations before sending them into the land that had been promised to them. And if you know me at all, you know I can hardly get through a sermon or a teaching without quoting from the Message translation of the Bible. So here you go, and I'll conclude with this. Look at what I've done for you today, Moses said. I've placed in front of you life and good, death and evil. And I command you today, love God, your God. Walk in his ways. Keep his commandments, regulations, and rules so that you will live, really live, live exuberantly, blessed by God, your God, in the land that you are about to enter and possess. But I warn you, if you have a change of heart, refuse to listen obediently, and willfully go off to serve and worship other gods, you will most certainly die. You won't last long in the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today. I place before you life and death, blessing and curse. Choose life. Choose life. Amen.